Good afternoon, friends. I'm Dr. Ajay Shah, and we are bringing you an exciting Facebook Live this afternoon. So good afternoon to all our East Coast friends. Good morning to our West Coast friends, and a great evening to some of the friends joining from India, actually. Matter of fact, this will be one of the few live where we have guests from all over the world. I have some exciting announcement. We have now about 22,000 followers on our Facebook page. And they are pretty much worldwide. We have some followers from Australia, some from New Zealand, some from India, obviously, lots are from US. The thing is, we have about 70% women followers on our Facebook page. So a large proportion of our followers are women. So I've taken a special mission to not only empower every woman, but also talk more about women issues. And in that regard, you know, today we have an exciting live for all of you. So if you are on Zoom, please mute your audio whenever you join. If you are also on Zoom, you can share on your Facebook feed so other people can watch it along with you. You know, let me set a stage before we invite our guests. In America, chronic diseases are becoming very, very common, like obesity, diabetes, high blood pressure, Alzheimer's disease, and many times it's because of the lifestyle. And myself and many doctors and many policymakers have realized that the traditional approach to this chronic disease is failing. Matter of fact, chronic diseases are becoming more and more prevalent as we go every year. So we need a new approach. And that's where I'm bringing this guest today, where I met her at our American College of Lifestyle Medicine board certifying exam in Indianapolis. And we became close friends. We are on our WhatsApp group where we discuss about various aspects of lifestyle medicine, how we can advance the cause of lifestyle medicine, not just in America, but also India and worldwide. So let me introduce her. She is an endocrinologist, Dr. Mahima Gulati. She's in Connecticut. She's also board certified in lifestyle medicine. So let's welcome Dr. Gulati. Welcome, Dr. Gulati.
Thank you, Ajay. Thank you so much. I'm honored to be here.
Yes, this is very exciting. I think we already have about 20 on Zoom call, and lots of people are already watching on Facebook. So that's a great, great feeling for all of us. So let me also introduce that she's not only a physician, but whatever I see her, the way she is functioning her practice, she's a great coach also. And I realized that most physicians, unfortunately, are not good coach. But Dr. Gulati is not just a physician, but a great coach also. So today we will have a lot of coaching from her about various chronic disease and various medical conditions. So have your questions ready. We will take questions on Facebook Live. So I will read out the questions at the end. On the Zoom, we'll take questions at the end. So have your questions ready. But let's start with Dr. Gulati. So Dr. Gulati, please explain, what are some of the common disease we see in America as a chronic disease, and what are the reasons for it?
So first of all, I want to extend my gratitude to you, Dr. Shah, and you know, it's a wonderful thing that you're doing on Facebook. I really admire, you know, your passion, your service to the, you know, the benefit of all of our society, our patients, and you know, it's a pleasure to know you and a privilege to, you know, get to work with you. So in response to your question about, you know, the chronic diseases, just like you, all of us, you know, found sort of a mission, a common mission in how we see all of our chronic diseases are really spiraling out of control, right? At least 6 or 8 of 10 Americans are suffering from chronic diseases. I'm here to talk about diabetes, but the chronic diseases, you know, they include the leading killers of Americans, the heart disease, the kidney disease, lung disease, Alzheimer's, stroke, cancer. They're all chronic diseases, right? So, and they're super common nowadays, unfortunately, and they are a direct not a side effect, but a byproduct of our lifestyles. And diabetes is, you know, it affects 13% of all American adults. So type 2 diabetes being the more common, 95% of all the adults that suffer from diabetes have type 2 diabetes, which is a lifestyle disorder.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. I think chronic disease is, like as I understand, after 65 Medicare population, most people have 3 or 4 chronic disease, and they are on at least 4 or 5 medications. So I think that definitely need to be reversed. And I think people like person, doctor like you, people like you can definitely play a major role. So let's start with diabetes. Please explain how the diabetes, the underlying mechanism, how the diabetes happens, and who are at risk of developing type 2 diabetes.
Yes. Thank you so much. So, you know, diabetes is a condition where a person's blood sugar becomes abnormal, right? And that's a process that happens over a few months to a few years. The bothersome thing now is, Dr. Shah, that, you know, even children, even young adults are starting to get type 2 diabetes. So it's starting to get more and more common, but it's also starting to happen at a younger and younger age. And, you know, it starts off as what we call pre-diabetes, which is, you know, when you're testing sugar, I think there is a little bit of noise. If, our audience can mute themselves. So talking about pre-diabetes, you know, that would be when the fasting sugars or the glucose are not as high as to be branded or, you know, labeled as diabetes, which is 125 or higher. But the sugars are higher than what a normal person's sugar would be considered, which is above 99. That would be the fasting sugar, or if they're, you know, like post glucose tolerance test sugar is higher than 140, that would be pre-diabetes. And of course, you know, diabetes is when their sugars are above 200, frankly, or their A1Cs are, you know, A1C is a measure of how your sugars are in the last 3 months. And if their A1C is above 5.6%, that's considered pre-diabetes. So it starts off as pre-diabetes, which, by the way, 1 in 3 American adults have. Imagine, you know, 1 in 3 people sitting in the room. But if you're a person of color, 1 in 2 chances, that's a 50% chance. As an American adult, we have pre-diabetes. And pre-diabetes is abnormal. You know, that basically means the risk of getting diabetes in our lifetime is very, very, very high. So how does this start? It starts essentially as a lifestyle disorder. And, you know, lifestyle is, as, you know, Dr. Shah, you must have educated patients, I mean, people across your Facebook portal, is, you know, amalgam of 6 big things, 6 key pillars, where we are, you know, starting to have problems lately in the last few decades. One, of course, is diet, our eating patterns. The second is our physical activity. The third is our sleep. The fourth is our stress management, or, you know, our the way we handle stress in our life. 5 is, you know, our use of risky substances like tobacco or alcohol or substances, illicit substances like drugs. And last but most important, actually, is how we connect with others, how we love and, you know, relate with other people in our society. So these are the 6 big arenas that we are starting to face disorders in or dysfunctions in the last few decades. And that has led to, you know, a big, like a cataclysmic rise in all of our lifestyle disorders. And, you know, pre-diabetes and diabetes, which are the same spectrum, are unfortunately also essentially a byproduct of these lifestyle disturbances. And what happens here is that, you know, all of these factors combined can essentially overwhelm our body's ability to process sugars that we eat. And we start getting high glucose circulating in our blood. And when we have high glucose circulating in our blood, that is not good for our health. It can have major effects on our body organs. You know, it can lead to damage to our eyes' retina. It can lead to damage to our nerves. It can lead to damage to our kidneys. It can, of course, lead us to have a higher risk for having heart attacks and strokes. And so having high glucose circulating in our blood is a big problem. And that's what the condition of diabetes and pre-diabetes entails.
No, I think I'm glad you mentioned all 6 pillars, because many times I realized that some doctors actually emphasize that, you know, it's a eating disorder. But I agree. I think diabetes is actually affecting all 6 pillars. I think people who don't sleep well, they have high chance of developing pre-diabetes and diabetes. People who don't exercise, people who abuse alcohol and other substances. So I agree. I think all 6 pillars are very important to prevent the pre-diabetes and reverse the diabetes. So I think, please explain that, as I read more, that the mechanism of developing diabetes, the cellular mechanism or a medical mechanism, is having the fatty acids entering the cell and making insulin not work properly. So please explain more on that.
Yeah, so, you know, there are basically the way that our body controls our blood glucose, right? So when we eat any food, the purpose of eating that food is so the fuel, the glucose, can get into our body cells, like our muscles, like our liver, like our brain, in order to fuel our, you know, ability to function, right? And that is a mechanism that has been very nicely homeostatically controlled by nature. We have been given this amazing machinery. The big hormone that regulates our blood glucose is insulin, which is a hormone produced by our pancreas, an organ that's present in our upper abdomen. So diabetes is essentially a dysfunction of our pancreas's ability to produce insulin, or how this insulin acts on our body. There are two key mechanisms. One is, you know, that the pancreas does not make enough insulin, and the other is that insulin is there, but it's not working effectively. So it's been rendered ineffective. And the second condition is very common. It's what we call insulin resistance. So how this happens is that, you know, our body actually makes a lot of insulin. It makes more insulin than would be actually necessary or healthy. But the body's cells are not listening to this insulin properly. The receptors are resistant. Our body's liver is not being able to interact very well with this insulin that's being made. And that happens because there's too much fat droplets inside our liver cells. Same thing with our muscle cells. Our muscle cells have a lot of what we call intramyocellular adiposity, which is that there are fat droplets inside our muscle cells. And how do these fat droplets start accumulating in our muscle, in our liver, in other organs like our, you know, pancreases or even our heart cells? That happens because we might be consuming excessive, poorly chosen calories, right? So there is two things. One is quantity of calories, and the other more important thing is the quality of calories. If we are getting our food, you know, which is sugary beverages or alcohol, like you mentioned, or, you know, highly fried, ultra processed foods like candies or, white breads or pizzas and stuff, those are poor calories that accumulate fat, not just in our, you know, like body fat, the one that we can see, our, you know, subcutaneous fat, but also in the deeper organs of our body, our viscera, our liver, our muscles. And that fat, which should not be present in these organs, in the liver, in the muscle cells, that is what renders our body cells unable to interact very well with the insulin that's going around. So think of this, Dr. Shah, as a key and a lock, right? You need your insulin to open the lock. It's the key in order for the glucose to get through the door into the cell, right? That's the job of the insulin. It gets your glucose inside the body cell. But what's happening here is that your lock has been rendered dysfunctional. So the key is no longer able to open the lock. And so the glucose cannot get inside your body cells because the liver cells are saying, oh, you know, I cannot interact with this insulin. And the glucose is there, but it's hanging in the blood and hanging, you know, so much glucose, you know, to the levels of 100s, 200s, 300s. That is very bad for the entire body. And all this while all this glucose cannot get into your liver cells and into your muscle cells and so on.
Yeah, I think that makes so much sense. And I think, as I understand also, that obesity, you know, our own body fat cells releasing all those fatty acids, and obviously the saturated fat we eat from our diet, both fatty acids from our diet plus our own body fatty acids enter the muscle cells to start with, and then eventually liver and pancreas, even the brain. And I think that's a reason we all know that obesity is one of the largest, biggest risk factor for developing prediabetes and diabetes, because we carry so much fat cells to keep releasing those fatty acids 24/7, even when we are not eating. So my next question to you is that if a person has prediabetes or diabetes, if obviously they will need to change all six pillars, but if they want to start with the most important pillar is what they eat, what kind of diet in general you recommend for people with diabetes and prediabetes?
Great question. Yeah, I think first of all, thank you for mentioning the, you know, the fact about the obesity, our own body fats. That's true. And that again happens when, you know, we have over time accumulated all that excessive body fat into our organs and into our body by, you know, just poorly chosen calories. But diabetes, you know, we call it dietbetes in our office. And it really is dietbetes because, you know, the moment we decide to stop consuming those poorly chosen calories, it can really put a stop on the pathology. We can reverse it, like you mentioned. So the ideal diet is what, you know, I would refer our listeners back to the American College of Lifestyle Medicine's Healthy Plate, which is a very, you know, if we do that at least 80% of the times, 8 out of 10 times we do that, there's a very, very high likelihood that we can really control our diabetes very well, or pre-diabetes. And that plate, as you know, is half of our plate is filled with colorful fruits and vegetables. Vegetables, most importantly, you know, so your green colors like all the leaves, the spinach, the kale, the broccoli, the Brussels sprouts and so on. And all the colors of the rainbow, the purples like eggplant, the, you know, the blues like blueberries, the reds like, you know, peppers and tomatoes, the yellows like cauliflower and squash and so on. So if we have a lot of colors, and we don't have to have all the seven colors of vegetables at the same time, but the concept is that a really huge, you know, preponderant amount of food that we eat in our plate should be colorful, fresh or frozen vegetables and fruits. And then the remaining 1/4 needs to be healthy, intact, unrefined whole grains, like, you know, quinoa or buckwheat groats or wheat berries or oat groats and so on. And the remaining 1/4 plate needs to be a healthy protein, ideally with fiber. So, you know, our lentils, our legumes, our beans, they are a great source of proteins. Nuts and seeds, seeds like, you know, chia seeds and flax seeds and so on. So if we eat like that, and, you know, I tell my patients, if two out of all the three things that we put in our mouth are vegetables, colorful vegetables, and fruits, then, you know, we hopefully have no problem. Unprocessed, they have to be ideally, you know, essentially from the farm to the table without any intervening factories or processing involved.
Yeah, I think I agree. That's an excellent suggestion, because a lot of the patients who I deal with it now, many of them have been diabetic for 10, 15, 20 years. And some of them are on insulin up to 200 units. And just changing their diet to whole food plant-based, meaning raw and cooked vegetables without any oil and fruits and intact grain, they have not only reversed their diabetes, the insulin requirement has gone down in 1/3, 1/4, just in 2 or 3 weeks. So I think diet, like you said, it's a diet. I think you said in such a nice way that diabetes actually is a diet disease. It should not require any medications if you take care of your diet. So I think that brings my next question. We talked about whole food, plant-based diet. Right now, there is a big, big push for keto diet. Initially, keto diet came in vogue for people to lose weight very quickly. But now, actually, keto diet has been kind of proposed to be the panacea or the treatment for all type of diabetics. In my opinion, what I read as a cardiologist, the keto diet actually may bring your sugar down, but deep down, it's making your insulin resistance still keep going. And if anything, insulin resistance may be getting worse because of a lot of saturated fat in keto diet. So please tell us more about keto diet and what is your recommendation?
That's a great question, Ajay. So keto diet is very in vogue right now, as you said. It is, I think all the data that comes from the keto diet is because they've compared it to the SAD, the standard American diet, the SAD diet, as we call it. So of course, you know, when people go from eating what we call in our office garbage, you know, with a C as in carbohydrates. So those are the bad, you know, the refined processed carbohydrates, right? So if we are used to eating like white flours and white breads and desserts, and, you know, suddenly we start eating, you know, the keto diet, which, you know, essentially gets rid of all of these processed carbs. Of course, our parameters improve. To the best of my knowledge, I don't think we have a trial that studies a keto diet head to head with a whole foods plant-based diet and studies, you know, their glycemic control. in one wing versus the other. But the problem with the keto diet is 75 to 80% fats. You know, they say all of your 70% or higher of your calories should come from fat. And, you know, it lets you do hardly 25 to 30, maybe at the most 40 grams of carbs in a day. And it eliminates two very important food groups that we know are associated with a healthy, long life or longevity. One is legumes and the other one is whole grains. And it actually also excludes most fruits. The only fruits you're allowed is berries. So those three are actually, you know, three out of the six most important food groups that we know are important for human health. The remaining three are vegetables, nuts and seeds, and herbs and spices. And, you know, there is really no paucity of data. The science is in that all these six food groups, if we eat them unprocessed, we are going to be healthy, long-lived. So, you know, if you eliminate three out of the six important food groups, which are important for human health, I don't know what's the long-term effect of that. And the other thing that I tell my patients is never do a diet that you're not going to do long-term, right? Never, ever make a dietary change that you're not going to sustain. Unless, of course, you know, if it is your wedding day and you have to do something for the next, 1 to 2 weeks. And in those cases, also have better diets to recommend them than keto diet in order to lose weight. So, you know, short, in such a short term. But, you know, if you're going to eliminate these three very important food groups, are you going to be able to sustain it for the rest of your life? And if not, then the weight is going to come right back on. So I don't recommend keto diet because there are no long-term safety data. As you mentioned, it can cause some problems with LDL levels, especially if it's very high in, you know, saturated fats and stuff. You know, really, I mean, there are healthier ways to get the weight down and become overall, you know, able to get rid of diabetes and other chronic diseases and so on. So keto diet is not a panacea.
I think I agree with you. I think as I understand, the people in blue zones, let me mute that person. People in blue zone, where people live long, live healthy up to 100, they typically have 70% carb in their diet. And like you said, carb, actually, the company comes with carb is a lot of micronutrients, a lot of phytochemicals, a lot of B vitamins. But when you eat the typical keto animal products, it doesn't bring any good company. If anything, it brings bad company of saturated fat and animal protein. So I think carb always has been the healthy part of our diet. And eliminating carb, not only there has no long-term data, and I essentially think this keto diet actually is nothing but Atkins diet with new clothes. And Atkins diets actually has been gone now. People actually don't even follow Atkins diet. So I agree with you. I think, so my next question is, do you think the whole world should go vegan, or do you think there is a role of some calories coming from animal products? For example, Blue Zone, about 10% of the calorie come from animal products. So I personally feel like sometimes as a lifestyle physician, we've been kind of wrongly labeled that we want the whole world to be vegan. And I'm not necessarily in that camp. I feel like animal products should be used as like a treat, maybe once or twice a week if you enjoy it, but you don't have to go vegan. What is your thought on that?
So I think, you know, in terms of the there are three aspects to it. One is the health aspect, which is, you know, are you going to be necessarily healthier if you are completely vegan versus if you are, you know, less than 10% animal-based? I don't think the data is very clear. I agree with you in terms of, you know, the personal preference part or the ethics part. I think that's each individual to their own. I don't necessarily tell my audience or my patients to, you know, completely go cold turkey. And most of them will not be willing to do that. So I don't come to them with an agenda. I meet them where I see them, you know, I basically where they are. I think for the whole world to go vegan, the best study that comes to my mind is that Eat Lancet study, where they said, you know, I think they gave maximum quantities that every individual on the planet can eat in terms of the animal produce in order for us to be able to sustainably take care of the, you know, the 7 to 10 billion people that we are expecting in the next few decades, right? So that quantity, you know, just for sustaining our planet. We cannot all, you know, eat like three servings of animal produce a day. We cannot. It's just not sustainable. You know, we can't have cheese and meat at every single meal, all people in the planet. That is, you know, we cannot do that sustainably. So they recommended, you know, how much fish we can eat so that the entire planet will have enough, and so on. I think that's the study that I would recommend our listeners to go back and look at, Walter Willett and all the colleagues from, you know, Eat Lancet. So in terms of the health, again, I will work with my patients as long as they are doing a diet, like you mentioned, which has a huge plant slant, you know, plant predominant diet with all those six food groups that I mentioned represented adequately in their plate. If they're doing that, you know, then if they want to have a treat every now and then, you know, or, you know, like some sort of, you know, cheese or steak once in a blue moon, I don't think that's going to really hurt their health.
Yeah, I think I agree. I think like ultimate goal would be to go vegan. But I think we need to make small steps. And I think many people, like when I see a patient, many of them have connection to certain animal products from their childhood. And I think too many times to bring them into the camp, the systematic stepwise slow approach works better than just becoming very strict from day one that you need to go vegan. I think my experience is that as people start to eat whole food, plant-based, they automatically start feeling so much better that they themselves actually start avoiding animal products. So I think they become their own teacher instead of us pushing on something, because I think by pushing on, they may get turned off and they may never come and see you. So I think taking a small stepwise approach always works, in my opinion, better. So let's go next two pillars. Please explain what the role of sleep and exercise for both pre-diabetes, diabetes, and in general for our health.
Yeah, I'm glad that you had mentioned, you know, sleep in the beginning of our talk. You know, sleep is a big one. I think one of the studies that I was very impressed with, you know, when we were doing our lifestyle medicine certification exam, was I think how they took healthy subjects, you know, healthy adults, and they made them sleep deprived for just a few days. I think it was like, you know, they did not let them sleep for longer than, I think, 4 hours at night for 6 days. Or it was, you know, they made them sleep less than 6 hours at night for 4 days. It was one of the two. I forget which was which. But within 6 days or 4 days, these healthy subjects developed, you know, impaired fasting sugar. It was that rapid. You know, imagine just being sleep deprived for a few days. You're only sleeping like a few hours at night, and your fasting sugar becomes impaired, and these are healthy subjects. So the impact of sleep is huge, you know, and I think there are some really, like, you know, popular cultural aspects to that. I think there's a Bollywood star, I'm not gonna name him, but he prides himself on not sleeping more than 4 or 5 hours at night. You know, and I think it's, people don't realize how important sleep is in terms of our overall health, not just, you know, diabetes, but also our risk for having heart problems. Lack of sleep is one of the biggest inflammatory cascade, you know, you can really unleash a lot of inflammatory problems in your body by just, you know, not sleeping well for a few nights in a row. That's number one. And, you know, Dr. Shah, the number two thing that we always screen the patients that come into my office for are obstructive sleep apnea, which is, you know, very common. So if I'd recommend my listeners, you know, if they have their patients or if they know somebody in their life who has, you know, symptoms like, you know, they are really sleepy during the daytime, they're really likely to fall asleep if they are, you know, like doing nothing, if they are just sitting and watching TV and they can fall asleep at the drop of a hat, that's excessive sleepiness during the daytime. Or if they have, you know, snoring problems at night, they, you know, wake up frequently in the middle of the night, gasping for breath, or if they have high blood pressure, those are all, you know, symptoms that could suggest underlying obstructive sleep apnea. And, you know, a lot of my patients who come into the office, they are really unusually tired. And it ends up that we, you know, end up unmasking or, you know, diagnosing sleep apnea in a lot of our patients. So that's a very common condition that we as clinicians should look out for. And that, again, has a huge role to play in terms of, you know, setting up inflammation in the body and causing, you know, abnormal sugars and other chronic diseases like, you know, liver problems or blood pressure problems and so on. So that's for sleep. And, you know, unless if you have any inputs, then I'll go on to exercise.
No, I think sleep apnea, I'm glad you mentioned that, because a lot of the patients who have diabetes also carry obesity. And I think obesity is one of the major risk factors for sleep apnea. And like you said, until you treat the sleep apnea, insulin resistance may keep getting worse, because sleep apnea is a condition where we have chronic elevation of those norepinephrine hormones, and a lot of atrial fibrillation happens, which I see many patients. So I agree, everybody with diabetes, obesity should be screened for sleep apnea. I agree with you. And now I think with the home sleep study, it's so easy for people to just get a machine from your office and get screened at their own house, you know, instead of coming to a center like we used to do in the past. So I agree. Let's go to the exercise now.
So yeah, exercise again, you know, the role of exercise cannot be, you know, overemphasized. I think it behooves all of us to make sure that, you know, people in our lives, we ourselves, and, you know, we educate every single patient that we should meet the, you know, the minimum criteria set by the Department of Health and Human Services, which is, you know, 150 minutes of weekly moderate intensity exercise, or at least 75 minutes of vigorous intensity, and that's the aerobic exercise in a week, and two additional sessions of, you know, resistance exercise that should involve both the upper body and the lower body in a week. So that is the minimum laid out by the federal authorities. And, you know, I make it a point to, you know, either write down exercise prescription or more than exercise, you know, as Dan Buettner, the, you know, the person from Blue Zones, he recommends just, you know, incorporating more movement in our day-to-day lives. So making sure we take frequent breaks from our, you know, sedentary, like sitting down in front of the desk all the time, making sure we don't do that for longer than 20 minutes at a stretch. You know, just getting up, doing a few stretches, doing a few jumping jacks, or, you know, just moving in a natural way, you know, doing chores around the house, doing gardening and so on. Those are all very important for, again, you know, just improving the body's sensitivity to the insulin. And it's very important for our patients with pre-diabetes and diabetes to incorporate a minimum amount of exercise, the more the merrier, especially if it is natural. You know, we're not talking about high intensity. You don't have to become a marathoner in order to get rid of diabetes, but just, you know, making sure that we sit less and move more. And that has, you know, incredible benefits for getting our sugars under control.
No, I think I agree with exercise, that only about 15% of Americans get 150 minutes. So that's about 20 minutes a day. So 85% of Americans don't even exercise or physically active 20 minutes. That to me is not only not acceptable, but actually it leads to many, many health conditions, number one. Number two, they say that you don't have to, even if you exercise 2-3 hours, the most benefits are achieved by just doing 20 minutes. So if you do 20 minutes, you probably will achieve 80-90% benefits of what exercise can provide you. So take that 20 minutes and reap all the benefits, and you don't have to go to gym for 1 hour. And like you said, in those blue zones, they don't go to a gym. They move every hour. They do gardening. They mow the yard. They go to the friend's house walking. They go to grocery shop walking. I mean, they just incorporate like hour to hour activity. And like they say, sitting is new smoking. So every person with a desk job, you know, like accountants, computer programmers, they should get up every hour. And even the Fitbit device now has a reminder to move every hour. So I think there are various ways of pushing yourself to move every hour as much as possible.
And the one thing that I would like to add on to that, you know, the exercise part is, you know, just do what you enjoy to do. You know, for some people that's, you know, dancing. For some other people, it is, you know, some kind of a Zumba class or something that they would do with their friends. For other people, it's like playing with their kids. For some people, it's martial arts. So, you know, do something that, you know, you're going to keep on doing long term.
I think that's an excellent point. I think if you make physical activity as a joy, either with a company or by yourself, whatever you enjoy, you have a higher chance of consistently doing it and doing it for life. I agree with you. I think my next question, and then we will conclude the diabetes. My next question, there are some newer diabetic medications are available now. A lot of patients, as a cardiologist, come and ask me that, am I qualifying for some of these newer medications, because some of those medications have significant benefits in terms of heart failure, even some high blood pressure. So please explain some of the newer medications. You don't have to go into the names and details, but just the role of new medication.
So I think the two big ones that you are talking about, and I'll mention the third one just in case, although I don't think they are that earth-shatteringly beneficial in terms of heart problems. The one class that I think you mentioned in terms of the heart failure that, I'm sure you and Dr. Reddy, they get questions about all the time are the SGLT2 inhibitor class, which is the drugs that have the Flozin at the end of their name. So empagliflozin or Jardiance is a big one. And then the other ones are the Farxiga or the dapagliflozin. These drugs, they were shown to have, some benefit on their the patients who actually have pre-existing heart failure, because they may have like a diuretic, a glucosuric effect. The problem with these drugs is they're not very good for their A1C lowering effect. In fact, if anything, I see many patients of mine, paradoxically, actually their sugars go higher. And there is a real risk for, developing what we call euglycemic diabetic ketoacidosis. So I would never start it on patients who I know are at risk of having insulinopenia, as in they are taking multiple doses, daily doses of basal and bolus insulin. Those are the patients who I suspect they might actually have baseline pancreatic insufficiency. They may not have enough islet reserve. And I feel very hesitant starting them on this class of drugs, because I think that can unleash diabetic ketoacidosis, which is a very life-threatening condition. But they do work in patients who they were shown to lower mortality in patients who have significant heart failure, especially patients who might be also at risk of compromised kidney or having some degree of kidney dysfunction that can prevent them from worsening and going into end-stage renal disease. The problem with these drugs is they all come with, side effects. So one is a DKA, but there are also problems like Fournier's gangrene was reported, which is a very severe infection of the genitalia in men subjects. So when I mention all these side effects, most of my patients don't want to take it. They're like, oh, I'd rather just, go the lifestyle medicine route. It really depends on how we present the options. If you present the option of, like the A1C lowering is hardly 0.7% at best. And there are all these side effects, but then there is lifestyle medicine, which is a gift that does not stop giving. There is no limit to how much A1C lowering you can really do by fixing somebody's lifestyle. You can absolutely easily achieve 0.7% just by, eliminating some of the offending foods. So yeah, that's, and they're very costly. You can never get them without, getting prior authorizations with most insurances. And you have to fail a lot of the other classes of drugs. So that's the one class. And the other class that I think you were talking about is GLP-1 analogs, which are, I think I like them a little better. They are drugs that, work on an incretin axis hormones in our body. So this is, hormones that are produced by our small intestines in response to food. And it turns out that diabetics, the patients with diabetes, this axis also does not work, just like insulin does not work that effectively. There's a discrepancy in the incretin hormone axis too. So they kind of mimic the action of incretins, and they decrease the postprandial surge in glucose. But one very beneficial effect that they have on our bodies, they tend to really decrease the appetite. Patients start getting full by eating much less, sometimes very impressively even half of what they were previously eating. So with GLP-1 analogs, we see a lot of success, especially with the newer ones that we have now in the market. The GLP-1 analogs are the so-called glutide. So our semaglutide and our liraglutide and our dulaglutide, those are the ones also known as Ozempic and Trulicity and so on. Most of them are injectable, although now there is one which is orally available in the market. Semaglutide, it's called Rybelsus. So that's a drug that a person can take once a day, the same time each day. And they do have an effect, a very notable effect on somebody's satiety. So they do bring down your postprandial glycemic excursion impressively, but that's because, you're not eating half as much as what you were eating before. And some of these like liraglutide were shown to have a beneficial effect on the cardiovascular outcomes also. There was a big trial on liraglutide and cardiovascular outcomes. And that's, again, I think because, you know, the decrease in the body weight overall and the inflammation overall, just because you are, you know, getting good glycemic control, but also eating less of the inflammatory foods. So we do use them. The problem is cost. The problem is injectability. And again, it's not a panacea. There are side effects. They can have problems with the pancreas. If there are some hints or suggestions that they may be associated with higher risks of pancreatitis and even pancreatic malignancy, although that's not settled yet. But there are some, you know, like some equivocal studies that suggest that. So I never use it in people who have a family history of pancreas malignancy or even medullary thyroid cancer with some patients. So that's in a nutshell about the new drugs.
No, I think I completely agree with you. I think when it comes down to type 2 diabetes, the best treatment is lifestyle change, because I think not only lifestyle change is going to benefit your diabetes and pre-diabetes, it's just going to make your overall health so much better. Your sleep will start improving. You will start living longer. Your blood pressure will come down. When you use this, some of these new diabetic drugs, only thing they do typically, other than some of them making you lose weight, only thing they do typically is control your sugar. But lifestyle, when you employ all six pillars, your whole body gets better. You start feeling better. You start even having better relationship. Your ED improves. Everything just starts getting better. And I think other thing I also kind of mentioned my patients that some of these diabetic drugs, particularly insulin, sulfonylurea, you have to worry about hypoglycemia. And I think that that's a reason, you know, the ADA recommends to have A1C goal of 7. But I think if you do lifestyle changes, and if you are not on any medications, you don't have to stop at 7 for A1C goal. You can keep going down until 5.6 or even lower as long as you are on no medication. So I think lifestyle changes can be the panacea. I agree with you completely. So let's go to the next topic, which some of the people are waiting already. They've already been sending a message on Facebook, is the thyroid. So please explain some of the common thyroid disorders, particularly the hypothyroid disorder, Hashimoto disease, because many, many people, particularly many young women, are already on thyroid replacement. So please go in as detail as you need to explain thyroid disorders.
Absolutely. Thank you. That's actually my niche area. So I'm glad that you brought that into the conversation. So thyroid, as you know, we all know, is a gland that is, it's an organ that's present right here where I'm pointing, just above our, you know, the sternal notch. It's a very tiny, like hardly 15 grams or 12 grams sized gland that is shaped like a butterfly. But a very important gland in our body. You know, glands are organs that make chemicals or hormones. So the thyroid gland makes the thyroid hormone, which is super important for our body's metabolism. And as we can all imagine, you know, it is not good to have imbalance of hormones. So either having high or low hormones is not good. And so the two commonest disorders are when the thyroid gland stops making adequate hormone, or underactive thyroid hormone, or hypothyroid. And the other one is hyper, which is, you know, when the thyroid gland is making too much thyroid hormone. And that's also getting quite common. So these are the two big, you know, thyroid disorders that I see patients for. And then the third disorder is thyroid nodule, which is, you know, when there is a collection of cells in the thyroid gland that people can somehow find, you know, either they feel it or they were getting some other CT scan or ultrasound and they just discovered this, you know, collection of cells in their thyroid. And those are also very common and they are referred to us. Now, in terms of the underactive thyroid or the hypothyroid or the Hashimoto's thyroiditis that you mentioned, Dr. Shah, that is becoming very, very common. At least 1 in 10 people, especially young people, are suffering from that condition. At least there might be more. And it typically is a disease of women, you know, 10 times more preponderant in women than in men. But men can get it too. It is what we call an autoimmune condition, typically in this country. You know, worldwide, that's not the commonest cause. The commonest cause of underactive thyroid in the world is iodine deficiency. But in the US, the commonest cause of underactive thyroid is autoimmune, which means that, you know, our immune system starts attacking its own thyroid cells. The word auto means self, you know. The immune system is not behaving properly. It's malfunctioning and it starts destroying the thyroid cells somehow mistakenly. And that causes a failure of the thyroid to function properly. So as I think most of our listeners know, autoimmunity is triggered by typically, you know, again, very lifestyle related, you know, stressors. Sometimes it can be unleashed by viral illness. Sometimes it can be unleashed by, you know, a change in a woman's body, like pregnancy or postpartum or menopause or even puberty. But I think the reason why it has really exploded, and now, you know, literally every person knows somebody who has thyroid issues, is because of our lifestyle, because of the ubiquitous availability of processed foods, because of lack of sleep, because of improper stress management. So those are all factors that are contributing to this surge in, you know, immune malfunction.
Yeah, I think like, you know, my own family, both my wife and daughter, they both had autoimmune and they both are on thyroid replacement. So I agree, it's just it's probably more than 10%. And like you said, typically common in young women. So next question is, there's a lot of confusion about certain vegetables and other things when people have hypothyroid. Can you please clarify those confusion with certain food like cruciferous vegetables and some of the other things?
Yes, I'm glad you asked. That's a question that I get asked all the time. And I think the three big ones are iodine, soy, and cruciferous vegetables. Those are the three big ones that we get asked all the time. So, you know, a lot of people that come to us, they are either taking iodine support or iodine tablets or something like that. And, you know, the one supplement that you should not take if you have thyroid disorders are iodine supplements. You know, we never recommend taking iodine supplements unless if somebody is, you know, pregnant or lactating, and then they should have iodine in their prenatal vitamin, really. But most of us living in the U.S. are not iodine deficient. Unlike, you know, there are various places in the world. I think some parts of Italy, they are iodine deficient. The soil composition there around Mount Vesuvius is iodine deficient. And then, you know, some goiter belts in the Himalayas and so on. But we don't do iodine deficiency in the U.S. because we have a public health initiative where, you know, we iodize our salt. So, and a lot of other foods are also like breads and stuff like that, you know, that's all iodine fortified. So iodine deficiency is kind of uncommon in the U.S. Although, you know, if somebody is doing a very restrictive vegan diet or some kind of a really restrictive, their salts are not iodized and so on, they may actually be at risk of iodine deficiency. So one should make sure that they're getting adequate iodine from their diet. I typically don't recommend supplements because they can have huge amounts of iodine. And huge amounts of iodine is a problem for the thyroid. It can cause both Hashimoto's and also, you know, overactive hyperthyroid conditions. So I would recommend that, you know, people either take a little bit, less than 5 grams a day of iodized salt, which is the safest way. Or if you don't have salt in your diet, just, you know, seaweed or naturally iodine-rich foods. Seaweed is the big one. You know, sea vegetables are the big ones. So, you know, arame or wakame. The ones which are a little troublesome are kelp and kombu. They're very rich in iodine. So too much of them daily is a problem. But I don't think people are over-consuming as a general, you know, seaweeds in general. So that's the big one. You know, a lot of people have questions about iodine. And, you know, I typically answer their whatever questions they have about iodine. I don't recommend, you know, these holistic, natural, you know, preparations, because we don't know what's in them. Their quality control, we don't know. So those iodine supplements, I don't recommend. The second one that we get asked commonly is soy. And soy, you know, the concept is that they have isoflavones, which tend to, I think they inhibit thyroid hormone synthesis by impairing the enzyme thyroid peroxidase, which is a key enzyme in the making of thyroid hormone. So again, you know, most people in the US, we don't overconsume soy. As you know, the blue zones, the Okinawa, they consume 6 times more tofu than we do, right? But I think in general, consume only organic, non-GMO soy, ideally unprocessed, you know, so the whole soybeans are great, or the edamame are great. And, you know, the really, really, you know, like textured soy protein and highly processed, ultra processed soy, I would not do too much of them, right? So, you know, consuming the soy products in moderation are actually very good for our health. They're associated with a lot of good benefits, including decreasing the risk of breast cancer and all. So really, you know, just organic non-GMO soy and moderation is great, but people don't have to eliminate soy or highly curtailed soy just because they have thyroid problems. Because, you know, in order to get that impairment in thyroid hormone synthesis, you need a huge amount of soy. And that's more a myth than reality. So I never tell them, oh, completely eliminate soy. Unless, of course, if they have soy allergy or something. And last but not the least is the cruciferous vegetables, which are actually, again, a very health promoting class of vegetables. You know, like Dr. Greger, in his daily dozen, he says at least one serving of crucifers every day. And I don't see why people with thyroid hormone, again, thyroid problems, again, cannot, you know, eat cruciferous vegetables daily. You know, I don't want them to like do pounds and pounds of kale smoothies in a day. That may actually cause goiter. The concern with crucifers is that they have a compound called thiocyanate, which again prevents, you know, it essentially interferes with thyroid hormone synthesis. And there are some thoughts that, you know, if we blanch these crucifers or if we cook them, that can deactivate that thiocyanate. But, you know, eating like a cup a day, again, has never been shown in rigorous clinical trials to decrease, you know, people's thyroid hormone production. I think there was a very bizarre case of like an 88-year-old Chinese woman who was eating 1.5 kilograms of bok choy, raw bok choy a day because she wanted diabetes control. So she got myxedema. That was a case report, I think. But really, if we are consuming cruciferous veggies, they're actually good and we should consume them. The one word of caution is if somebody takes, you know, levothyroxine or thyroid hormone replacement, they should take that on an empty stomach because levothyroxine can hardly be absorbed in our stomach. And, you know, like there has to be a certain acidic pH in our stomach in order to absorb it fully. And even then, barely 80% of that gets in, not 100% of that gets into our blood. So it is very critical to take levo on an empty stomach or any thyroid hormone, you know, armored thyroid or any on an empty stomach, and then not eat or drink anything at least for 30 minutes, especially if that food has a lot of iron in it or calcium in it or caffeine in it, because that can actually interfere that levothyroxine from getting into the blood. So, you know, soy milk, don't drink it immediately after taking your thyroid hormone supplement.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent, excellent point. And I think most doctors remind their patient, but I think I'm glad you put that right on the on our Facebook Live. Like, for example, my wife, actually, she keeps her thyroid and a glass of water right next to her bed. So as soon as she wakes up in the morning, she takes her thyroid with the water. And when she comes down, she prepares tea and this and that. By then, it's about an hour. So she has made a habit because what was happening when she would go down, and by the time she takes thyroid, the tea time is already there in 5-10 minutes. So now she keeps her thyroid right next to her bed. As soon as she wakes up, she takes the thyroid and the water, and then she starts her day. So, I mean, that's an excellent point. So that concludes our thyroid, and that brings up the next important topic, which has already been asked by many, many followers, is that what is a polycystic ovarian syndrome or polycystic ovarian disease? How common it is? What is the underlying mechanism, and what a woman should worry, what can it lead to?
Excellent. That's a very good, you know, so PCOS is another one of those, Dr. Shah, that's actually exploding. You know, and I think some of this is real increase in incidence, and some of this is that now people know about what it is. But, you know, if there are listeners here, it's actually the most common hormonal disorder in young women. It really is. So what it means is it's two things. Number one is that a woman has, you know, irregular menstrual function, as in that they don't menstruate every month. You know, the normal woman's menstrual cycle is every 25 to 35 days, you know, in that ballpark. You know, typically women will have a very strict, you know, like a 28 day on the dot. So if a woman doesn't have that, and, you know, their menstruation is anywhere from like every 3 months or every 7 months or so on, that's abnormal. And that's the one classic feature of PCOS. The other, the defining criteria is either clinical hyperandrogenism or biochemical. So, you know, if a woman complains about facial hair or, you know, loss of hair from, you know, the temple areas of the kind of like a male pattern hair loss, patches from, you know, the temporal or the scalp, that would be consistent with clinical hyperandrogenism. Or if they have biochemical, as in, you know, they go to a doctor and they get their testosterone levels tested or their DHEA levels tested and they are slightly high. So either one of those qualifies as hyperandrogenism. And if somebody meets both of these criteria, you know, that they have excessive androgen and they have irregular menstrual function. Those two are typically considered diagnostic of PCOS, provided, and this is a big one, that they don't have any other condition that's causing it. So they don't have any other, you know, that they have gone to a good family doctor or an endocrinologist, and they have ruled out other things like congenital adrenal hyperplasia or virilizing tumor and so on. So if somebody is concerned about PCOS, if they have these symptoms of irregular menstrual or disturbance, or if they have facial hair, et cetera, or acne, acne is a big one. You know, if you have severe acne, nodular acne and so on, then definitely please go to your family doctor and get, checked out, have your hormonal testing done. You know, the hormone tests that we do are, we do a fasting insulin, we do a fasting testosterone, some of the other hormones that I said, DHEAS, we check your A1C and so on and so forth in order to figure out if you have PCOS or not.
And how do you treat PCOS typically?
So PCOS is a very, it's a very heterogeneous condition. The hallmark of PCOS is what causes it is insulin resistance is what we think is the big driver, and also, there is a lot of oxidative stress and inflammatory stress. So all of these factors start affecting the ovaries improperly. And they're not making, the ovarian function is to, have like a mature follicle every month in each ovary, right? So if that is, prevented because there's a lot of oxidative stress going on at the level of the ovarian follicular cells, that is what drives the whole pathology. And these women are typically insulin resistant. They are typically phenotypically obese, although some of them are not. They are not phenotypically obese. They're just metabolically obese. So we treat that depending on what the symptoms are. If people are complaining about, weight gain, we can sometimes try metformin, even if they don't have prediabetes or diabetes. If their insulin levels are very high, we can try metformin. Metformin is a great drug to sensitize people to insulin. The other drug that we can try depends on, if women are not cycling regularly. And this is what the Endocrine Society guidelines are. We should try estrogen-containing birth control pills if they're not trying to get pregnant. So that will prevent them from having, the overgrowth of excessive facial hair. Ideally, a birth control pill which has progesterone, a typical progesterone would be, the one that has less androgenic activity, like desogestrel or norgestimate. So there are specific formulations that we recommend for women who have PCOS, not that, the typical norethindrone containing birth control pill. Birth control pill is the basic, the mainstay of the treatment. And last but not the least, we also sometimes use spironolactone depending on how severe somebody's facial hair or acne is. The thing with spironolactone is you cannot get pregnant on that. It's teratogenic. So first you should be on a birth control. Or some other kind of, contraceptive mechanism. And then you can take spironolactone, which will further prevent the facial hair development and the hair loss and so on. But again, the mainstay of, because we are here, the mainstay of PCOS is lifestyle, because it is a lifestyle disorder. And the oxidative stress is again caused by all of those things that we talked about, the six pillars, lack of sleep, too much, like processed food or, excessive meat or alcohol consumption, lack of adequate physical activity, and so on. So those are absolute mainstays of PCOS treatment.
Yeah, I think I agree. I think lifestyle probably applies to, in my opinion, pretty much every condition, even some of the genetic disorders. I think when the lifestyle is appropriate, many of these bad genes actually stay turned off. And actually, you will die with those bad genes at 100, but they will never get turned on if you have a healthy lifestyle. Because the genes in Japanese people, Okinawan people, I'm sure some of them carry bad genes, but their lifestyle is so good that they just live with those bad genes and never see the phenotypic effects of those bad genes on the body. So I think I agree. Lifestyle applies to every human medical condition, every condition.
Actually, I would like to, address, I think Mani has just sent me a question about how does lifestyle affect the PCOS. So, the reason why we are seeing an explosion of PCOS nowadays is because of lifestyle disorder. PCOS is essentially disorder of insulin resistance. So, you know, the same pathology that, you know, intracellular adiposity is present in places it should not be in. And the only way to, you know, not the only way, but a very good way to get rid of that insulin resistance at the level of the, you know, the hepatic specifically is a big culprit in PCOS, the hepatic insulin resistance, is again, lifestyle. So, you know, if we are doing low oxidative stress food, so, you know, none of those advanced glycation end products that come from, you know, fried meats and, you know, broiled meats and so on. But, you know, eating fresh produce and so on, that will decrease the insulin resistance. And in a lot of our cases, you know, like a lot of women, they lose like a modest amount of weight, right? A woman who's got irregular cycles and she's trying to get pregnant and she loses around 10 to 15 pounds, not a lot, just a modest amount. They somehow suddenly start cycling regularly and they become pregnant. So we see that all the time, you know, just by modifying our lifestyle, it can really reap a lot of benefits in terms of menstrual cyclicity and regularity, and therefore the chances of getting pregnant spontaneously.
Yeah, I think excellent point. Yeah. Let me ask you the last question. I think we did a great almost hour and 5 minutes. And the last question is for all our Indian Americans and people who are joining us live from India. Type 2 diabetes is becoming like a capital of the world in India. So what are some of the certain things which applies to Indian Americans like myself, you, and people in India? Why do we see more type 2 diabetes? And what can be done about it?
So yes, that is true. I think this is something that I feel very, you know, personally strongly about. You know, somehow, for better or for worse, we are set up for getting inflammatory disorders early, young, and at lower BMIs. So, you know, a lot of our listeners or friends may not know, but the criteria for obesity for Asians in general, you know, not just Indians, but also Asians, is much lower than criteria for obesity. So, you know, obesity is like defined as a body mass index of above 30 in a, you know, typical, you know, like a Caucasian American. But for South Asians, any BMI of above, I think 27 or 28, we are considered obese. And a BMI of above 23 or 23.5 is considered overweight. So, you know, we are genetically insulin resistant as such. You know, even at lower BMIs, I don't know if it is because our muscles are inherently, you know, insulin resistant, so-called sarcopenia phenomenon. And, you know, I think we talked about this at length at our, you know, Society of Lifestyle Medicine talk, where, you know, we talked about how our pancreases may not have enough beta cells, or that, you know, the mature functioning of the beta cells or the crosstalk among different beta cells may not be so developed that, you know, we really lose insulin production at a very young and a lower BMI threshold. So the what I'm trying to say here in layman's terms is that the Indian race is genetically susceptible to getting diabetes, to getting heart disease at a much younger age. You know, I see children getting diabetes in India at the age of 20, 25, like kids getting diabetes, type 2 diabetes at a young age, and also heart disease. You know, heart disease already starting over by 32, 35. And you don't have to be really, really overweight in order to get those conditions. So this is genetic, but yes, also some of this might be lifestyle, you know, that we don't maybe take care of our lifestyle as much as we should. Maybe our lives are more stressed out. Maybe we don't sleep as much. I don't know. But this is something that we need to be very aware about, you know, that we can have really early onset, really severe inflammatory conditions, chronic disorders, and we need to be on the watch out. We need to pay particular attention to our lifestyle, you know, making sure that we don't overconsume alcohol. We don't overconsume, you know, processed foods, meats especially. And we make sure that we stay physically active regularly, that we stay engaged in our communities, in our societies, we connect. And, you know, we take adequate, you know, rest and, you know, just pay attention.
No, I think those are excellent points. And I'm glad that we not only have our own group, you know, of lifestyle medicine from India, but also, as I understand, even India has its own College of Lifestyle Medicine, and it's becoming very popular. Even in my state of Gujarat, I think a lot of people are starting to look into certifying into lifestyle medicine. And I think India obviously cannot afford some of the expensive therapies what happens because of the poor lifestyle. Because you know, I think in America, we fortunately have a lot of the resources and we can take care of a lot of sick people with open heart surgery and stents. But in India, a poor person with a unhealthy lifestyle develops a heart disease, there's nothing left but to die because they don't have enough resources to bypass or stent done. So India needs more lifestyle changes than even America or any other westernized country.
Agreed.
I think this really actually was an excellent hour. There are some questions, like somebody made a comment that dairy, sweet, and meat in India is just so much prevalent, and that may be the reason, and I agree completely. I think dairy, actually, when I was growing up in Gujarat, we called it a white revolution because there was Amul dairy, which all Indians know, and all that cooperative work for dairy, and we thought that was the best thing happened to Gujarat. But looking back, actually, that probably possibly was a curse, actually, because dairy leads to so many. So I think I agree. I think dairy is one of the reasons. There was another comment that there was just a comment on the Facebook that we should be promoting lifestyle for every patient. And I agree completely that before we reach out for any medication, there's always a room for lifestyle changes in America. So I think, and I always recommend that, you recommend that, almost all lifestyle doctors recommend that. There was another question that if somebody has a low thyroid, can any lifestyle changes make that person completely go off thyroid medicine?
I knew this was going to be asked. So this is a tricky one. You know, please check with your doctor. If somebody has really borderline underactive levels, you know, if their TSH is just borderline, like 3 or 5, and if they just started with it in the last few weeks to few months, yes, there is potentially a chance that they may come off of their low dose of thyroid hormone replacement. But if they've had a low thyroid forever, for a long time, or if their thyroid hormone levels are quite low, as in their TSH is at least 7 to 10 or higher, then they really, you know, should not mess with that. I think they should definitely seek individual advice from their endocrinologist or their primary doctor. And, you know, such a patient may need thyroid hormone low dose or, at least a half dose, if not full dose replacement, depending on their thyroid activity. But no, I would not play with this. I would not address this just with whole foods plant-based. Yes, it will help you in terms of, managing your symptoms, because, a lot of times people with Hashimoto's also tend to have other coexisting symptoms of inflammation, like, joint pains, and brain fog, and muscle aches, and so on, that cannot be addressed just with thyroid hormone. So it really helps overall in terms of living healthy, but there are reasons to take thyroid hormone if their TSH is, bad enough. So please consult with your individual doctor.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent answer. I think I'm glad we covered that. The last comment or question, which we already covered, but she must be joining late in this session. Her question is, can PCOS be reversed with functional foods and physical activity and lifestyle changes? I think you already answered that, but please repeat the answer, because many women have joined late and they will tremendously benefit from your answer on PCOS.
So yeah, PCOS, I don't know what we mean by remission. Remission in this, I don't think there is an endocrine society definition of remitting or reversal of PCOS. But what we can call it is maybe ameliorating the symptoms, So can we regularize our menstrual cycles? Absolutely. Just by, reversing the way we eat, the way we, just our lifestyle, making sure we're getting plenty sleep, making sure we are exercising. Just a modest weight loss can really bring back the regular menstrual cyclicity. And in terms of the, the facial hair, typically what is already there doesn't get shed, but we do prevent, further follicular, basically hair follicular recruitment. So, worsening of hirsutism as time goes by will not occur if somebody is taking care of their lifestyle. So we don't really, as an endocrinologist, I don't have an official definition of reversal. Now, keep in mind, sometimes, if your, cyclicity has never started, beginning at puberty at 11 years of age or 13 years of age, if that, that pubertal time has been where, there hasn't been that, establishment of a regular menstrual cycle, sometimes people may not have regular menstrual cycles, but they may still be able to get pregnant because, you know what, we need barely like one follicular cycle every 3 months in order to be able to conceive, right? So four normal periods in a year are adequate to get be able to, you know, have a pregnancy. So yes, people can have good outcomes. In fact, you know, PCOS is one of the most easily treated causes of subfertility in women, in young women. So yes, lifestyle is a huge component. People can definitely have good effects in terms of ameliorating their PCOS symptoms with lifestyle changes.
Yeah, that's great. So again, Dr. Gulati, this was probably one of the top live we had. We've been doing it for about a month now. It's already been viewed by hundreds of people. It will be on YouTube in a few hours. So it will be available to everyone who wants to watch it later on, watch it again and again. And obviously the goal here is to educate everybody. We are not here to take care of your health issue as your doctor, but guide you, educate you, show you the lifestyle, and also, you know, make you a better person, not just a better patient, but a better person, overall a better human being. So I think Dr. Gulati brings a lot of those points, you know, more than most doctors I've dealt with in the past. I think in my opinion, some of the lifestyle pillars should be taught in every medical school from the day one. I think we will start respecting all six pillars, because if we go back and learn about lifestyle, it may be too late. So I wish medical school starts treating all the six pillars from day one. My daughter is in medical school and I tell her that if you really want to enjoy your medical practice when you go in practice and not burn out, start practicing lifestyle medicine. There's just so much more fun practicing lifestyle medicine. I think when I prescribe a Lipitor, it takes me 1 second, but I don't enjoy it. But when I talk about healthy diet, not only I repeat and rehearse for my own benefit, but I also make a special bond with a patient when I talk about their lifestyle. I think riding a Lipitor doesn't create that bond with a patient. So I think this lifestyle has changed my life. I know it has changed your life, Dr. Gulati. And we really appreciate you coming on. We will be bringing you on every 6 months with all the updates. So I think this has been a great session. I'm going to unmute everybody and see if...
Well, I think somebody... Thank you so much, Ajay. I mean, I really admire your passion and I'm so grateful to know you and to know all of our, you know, lifestyle medicine colleagues. You know, many of them are here, Kaushik, Bharti, Ashwini, and everybody else. I am really grateful to everybody. I think I'm going to take one question. Somebody asked me about lactation and whole foods plant-based diet. And I think, I don't know exactly, you know, what their question was in terms of, you know, plant-based diet during nursing. I have to say, to the best of my knowledge, I'm not very aware. I can go back and look about, you know, the if there are any good guidelines or any good, you know, papers on formulating a really good whole food plant-based diet during lactation. But I think it seems like they were able to get their A1C down to like a normal A1C just by, you know, doing what they're doing. So I think, you know, the role of whole grains in nursing is huge. We do know that whole grains, especially, you know, steel cut oat and, you know, all kinds of whole grains are big culturally also in nursing mothers, because, you know, breast milk is essentially, you know, the promotion of breast milk production through whole grains is a, you know, not just a folklore, but it's actually, you know, scientifically established. So I think, you know, just making sure that you're getting plenty of whole grains, lots of, you know, healthy carbohydrates, and of course, you know, just the healthy plate. But I think if you are looking at, you know, increasing milk supply, then maybe just eating more of whole grains would be a good idea there. Any other questions that you think, you know, Dr. Shah or...
Let me unmute everybody one more time.
Hey, Ajay and Mahima. Yes, Kaushik, how are you guys? This is good, awesome. Kaushik.
Thanks for joining. Yeah.
Absolutely, guys. This is unbelievable. Very, very nicely done. Proud of what you guys are doing. You know, one of the things that, you know, Mahima just, you know, mentioned about lactation and a plant-based diet. It's not my area of expertise. I don't really, you know, treat, you know, lactating mothers or infants. But one thing that I resorted to that I found very useful is in 2016, the American Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics, for the non-physicians in the audience, this is the governing body that oversees the certification of America's dietitians. And they published a position paper on nutrition. In that position paper, I just want to read it so I don't misquote it or paraphrase it. These diets are appropriate for all stages of life cycle, including pregnancy, lactation, infancy, childhood, adolescence, older adulthood, and for athletes. Plant-based diets are more environmentally sustainable than diets rich in animal products, because they are fewer natural resources and are associated with much less environmental damage. So this is actually a position paper by the leading authority that oversees the certification process for all of America's dietitians. They are officially in writing, continue to support a whole food plant-based diet to lactating mothers, infants, children, toddlers, older people, and athletes. So I love this document. I actually linked it on the Zoom chat.
So I think one thing I must say about Dr. Reddy, number one, he's coming live with us in 2 weeks. So I was going to keep it a suspense, but now he's on. So I'm going to tell everybody. So he's going to be another star. Second thing, I always been amazed and mesmerized that how he comes out with all the studies from his head in less than a microsecond. You know, I almost call him like a Khajana. He's like a treasure of all. I mean, every time I listen to him, he every time quotes based on evidence, based on science, not from his head, not from his experience. So that carries a lot of weight for me, for all of us. And I really admire the way he, plus I think, he's the type of person who doesn't mind jumping in to give the right opinion. And I think that's how we all should be. So we are looking forward to Kaushik, Dr. Reddy, in about 2 weeks. So that's a great comment. Thank you, Dr. Reddy.
Thank you.
So much the paper. Thank you, Kaushik.
Absolutely. Dr. Gulati, thank you again. I'm going to end here. But if anybody has any questions, they can put in our Facebook and we'll definitely get an answer from Dr. Gulati. Thank you again, Dr. Gulati.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.